the emergence of the threshold as a well-known specification of objectives certainly had a strong influence on examination providers. When ALTE was set up in the early 1990s, the early members were surveyed to find out what they were doing and to try and find ways to collaborate in putting together a frame of reference for international language qualifications. And it was very clear at that time that many had actually taken a threshold level and added an examination or developed an examination based on it, perhaps to complement existing exams which had been around much longer. So the preliminary English test in Cambridge was first developed, I think, in the early 80s, as you say, based on the early threshold, and then revised when the threshold was updated and revised with Jan van Eck in 1990, or to emerge in 1990. And I think that sort of process of examination providers having exams, which were taken into account, and then examination providers looking at what the framework concept was providing, and then developing new exams, saw this sort of evolution taking place even before the framework itself had truly emerged as, yeah, as a consensus by, let's say, the end of the 1990s.
Yes, yes, I think it is very important in the field of English as a foreign language, as opposed to most of the other languages with which the council were dealing, that it is an industry. There is an essential element of competition and an essential element of innovation. It isn't possible within the English field for people simply to copy what each other are doing. Each provider has to be able to assert their own independence and their own uniqueness in one way or another. And if you think of the textbooks that are published, there are such things as copyright. You have to do things which are individual to yourself. And so there is a dynamic for change in the need for variety and diversity. Whereas in the case of Dutch, for example, where my department collaborated with the Free University of Amsterdam in producing a course in Dutch as a foreign language, backed by the Dutch ministry, once that was done once, it was likely to stay the only course of its kind that was in existence for quite a long period of time. And English is not like that. And also, if we have the cooperation of the major institutions, private and public, working in the field of English as a foreign language, then there are very considerable resources which can be brought to bear. Unfortunately, not in a spirit of imposing a uniformity, but always in creating a common framework within which people can cooperate and also compete. That's very important.
If I understand you right, you're highlighting here some positive aspects of this. There may also be some negative ones, which perhaps we'll come on to later, about the nature of competition and whether or not that leads to positive outcomes or not. But just to sort of round off this sort of retrospective, which had looked at the lead up to the published version in 2001, what do you think was achieved? And did it actually meet your expectations in the early period just after the framework came out?
Well, I think the take-up was much stronger than we had anticipated. our intentions, I think, as an authoring group, were to provide an apparatus that would enable people to reflect on their own practice in the light of the general considerations, and to think whether what they were achieving or what they were testing, what they were providing as objectives for people using their textbooks and so on, whether this in fact led to the levels of proficiency that were in the scales, and whether it covered the various aspects of language use and language competence that were in the taxonomy.
Sure.
And then reflect upon their own practice, decide whether they wish to change it or to keep it, and to cooperate in the field as a whole by making explicit for other people what they were in fact doing. That's what we intended.
Mm-hmm.
But the driving force was comparability of qualifications.
Mm-hmm.
And it was in the sense of the use of the framework scales for establishing comparability among qualifications, which then dominated the take-up.
Right.
Although, of course, the more general aspects of the framework were used in teacher training.
Mm-hmm.
But it was the take-up by government agencies and by examining bodies,
mm-hmm.
which was overwhelming, and that overflowed out of Europe,
mm-hmm.
and into the wider world.
Sure.
Which we weren't expecting.
Well, I guess that's a good thing in the sense that you achieved a very widespread impact,
yeah.
But perhaps at the expense of narrowing the focus on some of the other issues.
For a while, yes. I think the longer-term take-up is more balanced.
Okay.
But I would emphasize that the extent of the take-up was not the result of the political intentions of the Council of Europe.
Mm-hmm.
The Council of Europe itself, in its higher echelons,
yeah.
rather felt that once the framework had been published, it should live its own life, and the Council of Europe should withdraw.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, what the Council of Europe has done since that time, as we shall see, is largely to provide mechanisms for cooperation and interaction,
mm-hmm.
among users in order to improve its application.